Hey, there's a new book out. I want you to order it. It's called Rooted by Banning. And he's a good friend of mine. I love him to death. You know what I love about Banning is I know Banning. I've known him now for about 6 years. I've called him for wisdom, and his character matches what you hear about him. And that's what I love about him. I know his character. I know his wisdom. He is just always been. I've been texting him back and forth. We've been texting each other on and off these last couple weeks about his book. So get it. You can get it on Amazon. Just Rooted is the name. I think it's Rooted. Just look for Banning's name. Make sure there's another book named Rooted. It's not his. So, and it's not Roots. It's Rooted. So don't order that CD pack, and unless you want to, of course. You know. But it's a really good book. And then later on this year, Jack's going to have Papa Jack's going to have his new book on the kingdom coming out. And it's taken him 13 months to write. And he says, my publisher wanted 75,000 words, and I was up to 105,000. So I got volume one, volume two. And he read us a little bit about the last chapter in the book. And I'll share it with you maybe, or maybe I'll have him share it with it when he comes up to the house. You know, it's basically, if we understand how he came, we can understand how the kingdom comes. Basically, let me just give you a synopsis of it. It comes to those who sell out everything for the king. That's how the kingdom comes. If you don't sell out everything, if you're just trying to play around, if you're not fully, God, I give you everything I have. It doesn't mean you have to give. It doesn't mean you have to sell everything. It just means it's got to be available for his asking. It doesn't mean go sell everything and chase after him. It just means chase after him and leave everything up to him in your life for his choosing. There was a friend of mine, had a friend, multimillionaire, lived in Mexico, had this like castle, and he had all this art and stuff. And he says every year, a couple times a year, the millionaire would walk around his house and he'd go, Lord, what do you require from me this year? Whatever you want, I'll give it away. And he'd walk around his house, and sometimes it would be an art piece worth $1 million, $2 million. And he'd walk around his house and go, what do you require of me today? You can have it all. You want me to sell everything? And he would do that constantly. And so that nothing ever got his heart. So that's a pretty good deal. How many people want the kingdom? I want the kingdom. All right. Well, open up your Bibles, Bibles. I'm going to talk to you about the women in the kingdom of God. Women of the kingdom. And unbeknownst to man, God really has a place for women in the kingdom. And without women, there would be no more men. There would have been a man, but there would have been no other men or women, right? So a lot of times what we do, what denominations do, you know, I love that people are finally grasping that women can preach. But I've been doing that for 20 years. I'm really flattered that they're starting to get that. Because they take one verse, one passage, context of Paul at the Corinthian church, women be silent in the churches. Now in the Greek, there's no difference between the word woman or wife. There is no distinction between the two words, the one word. They use the same word. That could be translated both. And they take an instance in the Corinthians where there was already enough controversy, and Paul tells them, wait until you go home and ask the question. Don't ask it in the meeting because there's already enough controversy going on in questions that you're just stirring up more of it and you're creating disruption in that. But it's not meant to be a doctrine of the church. Matter of fact, Paul goes through this whole thing, women should be covered, you know that. I think it's 2 Corinthians 7. It goes, so women should be covered. And he says, we hold no such custom in the church. So I want to point out a couple of the women of the kingdom and understand that these women shifted kingdoms, shifted the course of countries. Jesus, in Luke, women are mentioned in the lineage of Jesus. The women are kind of important. There's a couple things I don't like hearing, okay? And I think for some reason this has become like a popular statement. I think it's a very stupid one. That is, if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. Well, then your woman is just a real pain in the butt. How's that? I mean, what you're telling me is when your wife is having a bad day, she makes everyone around her miserable. Well, isn't that special? That's godly. If you're having a bad day and you make everyone else around you miserable, you're going to not have a lot of people around you for long. I'm just sorry, it's not the kingdom. And so I had one friend who called his wife the Black Mamba. Well, she'll strike you. But, well, isn't that special? And it becomes almost like a mantra, like she's tough. And it's a sad day when women have to act as stupid as men to be accepted. It's a really stupid thing to make women be as stupid. By the way, that's not a good statement for men. If daddy ain't happy, you know what? That ain't a good statement for men either. That's not the kingdom. The kingdom isn't about us and everyone making us happy and everything going our way. And if it doesn't go our way, I'll tell you what, you will know it's not going my way today. Wait until I get to work. You know what I mean? Or wait until I get home. You know, that's just not the kingdom. And it's kind of a birthed out of women trying to be men, thinking that men were the model. Men are not the model. Jesus is. And there are some very amazing women in Scripture. One of my favorite is Esther. Esther is one of my favorite women in the Bible because she has royalty all over her. And she takes one of the biggest risks in that's going on in her kingdom, and that is, if you approach the king and he did not summon you, he will kill you. And he's not against killing the queen either if he has to. And yet, she goes in there and she shapes the course of that nation and saves her people. She's even given the authority by the king to write decrees. The church in Scripture is seen as our mother, but also Holy Spirit is seen as that nurturing one, the mothering of God. He's the one who brings comfort. Most mothers are the comforters, and they're the teachers in the household. They teach the kids, right? And if you ever go through a sozo and you understand the father's ladder and stuff like that, you get into that the Holy Spirit is the nurturing one, okay? And if you have a really, really strong God like we do, you're going to need a nurturing spirit to comfort you. And he's there to comfort you because God's going to ask you to do some pretty crazy stuff. You're going to need it sometimes, you know? And Esther is one of those people in Scripture who just show how a woman, you have Deborah, you have Ruth, you have all these people, you have Sarah, you have Rebecca. You have all these people who were strong. Yep, they had, you know, the great thing about Scripture, it shows you where they had troubles too. Esther, we don't really see trouble. She's very beautiful. You know, she goes through 12 months of purification and preparation, 6 months of myrrh, 6 months by spicy perfumes, which tells you anytime you think you're going through hell, there is a season of rejoicing and sweet-smelling fragrance that's going to come out of it. I can't tell you how many people, ministers I know, who go through very difficult seasons, but because they handle that season well, there's promotion at the other end of the season. The problem is most people don't go through well, so they don't go through the season. They just get relief from the season, and then they get to go through the season again. By the way, Manning will touch with some of that. You will go through seasons that are harder than others. Anyone have figured that one out yet? The question is, how do you handle those seasons? Paul said, I know how to be in plenty and know how to be in lack. In all seasons, I'm sufficiently supplied with Christ. That's my paraphrase for you. He basically says, look, I know how to have abundance. I know how to be in need. It doesn't matter what situation I'm in. I've learned how to trust the Lord through those things, so I respond well to what's going on. A lot of people really need to learn that. Again, you know, do well even in the bad seasons. A lot of times people only motivated when things are going well. But are they motivated to do well even in the driest seasons? And that's the key, is do you change? Are you a seasonal person, or are you a kingdom person which has no seasons? That's key. So Esther's one of those great ones. But I want to talk to you about Mary this morning. Let's think about Mary, the mother of Jesus. Charles Caron, we were talking about it down there, and Charles Caron gave some information, very good, useful stuff. Like, Mary was not really mentioned around the church for the first 300 years. Like, she wasn't a focal point. And then she started, you know, in the Gospels, you know, they started talking about her a little bit more. And it wasn't until 1600s in the Catholic Church that they kind of started elevating Mary. And it wasn't until the last 70 years that Mary became deity. They now, in some Catholic circles, they believe Mary was born of a virgin herself. She was not. But she is blessed of all women. And at the cross, Jesus takes care of his mom. Son, behold your mother. Mother, behold your son. I mean, he's thinking about his mom. And I want you to think about a woman who's at the age of about 14 years old and garners so much favor from God. It says she's greatly favored, that God would allow his son to come through her. Trust me, God has not chosen this lightly. This is an amazing prophetic event. All the world is about to change. And a 14-year-old girl is chosen to carry the Son of God. That's favor. Her aunt, Elizabeth, who's much older than her, her cousin, I think it might be her cousin, Elizabeth, much older than her, is also found favor. Somewhere along the line, faith consumes Mary. She has some questions. They're not doubts. It's really just like, I don't know a man. She has a question of procedural conduct for this to happen. How is this going to happen? I've never known a man. I know I'm betrothed. Is this coming after? It's a valid question for her to ask. But think about it, because she's about to get pregnant outside of wedlock, which by way she could be put away quietly or very publicly or even stoned. You think the Muslims are the only ones who put their kids to death? The Jews did too. It's a very frightening thing she's about to experience. Somewhere along the line, by the way, for her to bring the kingdom, because she's bringing the king, and he's bringing something with him, she has to just say, okay, God, whatever she says, let it be unto me according to your word. That's an all-in statement. Now that word, it says, with God nothing is impossible. I think it's Luke 2:52. Luke 1:38, I think it is. Luke 2:52 is Jesus grew in favor and stature with God and man. Let's see. This word in Luke, verse 37, 1:37, for with God nothing will be impossible, is actually a very poor translation of the word. And I've told you this before, that word nothing actually means... Actually, let me try to paraphrase it for you, what it actually means in the Greek. When God speaks, in his word is the grace and power to do what it says it's going to do for you. It's Isaiah chapter 55. For God's seed does not his word does not return to him void, but accomplishes that which it was sent to accomplish. That's what that actually means in the Greek, and it's very bad translation. With God, nothing is impossible. It's very bad because the word nothing, there is three Hebrew words, and one of them is rhema. God's rhema word, his spoken word coming forth. We go, well, this is written word. It was at first spoken. And God's word is able to do what it said, but what's the requirement for it to work? Faith. You have to mix your faith with the word, and Mary puts her faith on the line. You got to understand, this is like, she doesn't have a counselor here. In other words, she can't go and see if it's okay. She can't go ask her parents. She's meeting with an angel. She's got a counsel with her. It's called an angel Gabriel, and he comes to her, and he's got this message for her. And she either says yes now, or we never hear of her again. Now, you go, well, God had to know. Well, I believe God knew what character he was dealing with. Because he says she found great, she was greatly favored. Greatly favored. How many people would like to be greatly favored of God? For those who think it's only the new covenant that has favor and grace, I guess they didn't read the scripture. Great favor. I mean, let's go back to verse 26. Let's go 28. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." But when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying. Very humble person. You know what she didn't do? Yeah, you're right. You got that announcement right. I am favored. You ever tell someone, "Hey, man, God bless you. I am blessed." Well, aren't you a precious prize? The scripture warns us not to think more highly of ourselves than we ought. She considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do you not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God." Wow. I often try to teach people how to use the grace you've been given to acquire more grace. That grace, favor, means I get to come to God. And the more I use that to come to God, the more grace I actually receive. Does everyone start out with the same measure of grace? Say no. I know that sounds really hard to understand. But he does sometimes show grace. Why? Because there's some people, I was not one of them, who was not really a foul, dirty pig before I got saved. Okay? And I was. So, you know, I had to take the grace I was given and I had to use that grace and go farther. You understand that? And if you don't use the grace on your life, then why should God give? People are asking for more faith, more grace. They haven't used what they've got. You don't need more faith, really, because you got enough to move mountains. All you need is a mustard seed to do that. You need more boldness. You need a new identity. You need to know who you are in God. You know, I think a lot of people, it's not that they suffer from a lack of faith. They suffer from low self-esteem. You have to believe what God says about you. Would be nice if some people. Like, you know, God says you're his son. Do you believe it? Or do you still believe you're an orphan? Do you know under Jewish law, you could forsake a natural son, but you could not forsake an adopted son? That once you adopted son, you could not cut him out at all. But your natural son, you could. In other words, once you chose to be a father to an orphan, you couldn't make him an orphan again. But you know how many Christians think God's forsaken them? And Jesus said, "I will not forsake you. I will be with you always." He sent us the spirit of adoption. But the problem is most people don't believe what God says or has said. Because they don't feel it. You don't feel first, you believe first. It's just really important. And that's, again, cultivating that garden, quoting what God has said about you versus what your thoughts are saying. All your thoughts don't originate in you or with God. Some actually originate in hell. I mean, we see this with Peter. He gets one revelation from the Father and one wrong word from the devil. Neither of them, Jesus doesn't say either of them originated with Peter. One, my Father has revealed it to you, and the other one's get behind me, Satan. Neither of those great statements, the statement of faith and the statement of stupidity, came from Peter. They both had other sources. So you have to remember, you know, who you are and cultivate that. I love Mary. I mean, just can you imagine an angel appearing to you and say, oh, yeah, by the way, you're 14. I'm going to get you pregnant when the Spirit overshadows you. You're going to give forth the Son of God, and he's going to, you know, be sacrificed. I mean, think about this for a second. It says she pondered this. I love it when it would say, take note of the times when it says, when Jesus says, don't you know I'm supposed to be about my Father's business? She says, boy, get in the car. Before I put you over, I've been looking for you for 3 days. Get in the car now. I will take off this sandal, boy, and I will smack you upside the head. But it says that when she walked away, it says, and she pondered this in her heart. She knows. She knows who her son is more than anybody in the room. She knows. And it's something that's probably been on her heart the whole time she's raised. She knows he's the Son of God. She knows. I mean, if anyone knows, Jerusalem knows what happens to those who are called of God. They kill them. They killed every prophet. They know. She knows. Like, if you're going to be that called, whoa, this isn't good. She might not have the full understanding, but she knows he's the Son of God. Others might think he's a prophet. She knows that he's the Son of God. She knows the truth. Joseph knows the truth. She knows. And she's pondering all this in her heart. She's carrying the burden with them. And she walks into Elizabeth's house. Isn't it amazing that two women are carrying the promise of God? What do you mean, Elizabeth? Yeah, Elizabeth is carrying the one who will be the forerunner of the Son, just as prophesied about as the Son. And they're both carrying these promises. And they both know by which persecution. Elizabeth is probably persecuted now because, imagine if she said, well, you know, this is what happened. You know, Zechariah was offering up the incense one day, and an angel came home. I came in there and talked to him. He came home a little frisky. You know? He probably never gets to minister in the house of God again. They probably, you know, it says they all realized he had a vision. And you think that that's received real well. Remember, it's been dead for 400 years. I remember that. And John is actually the rightful high priest in the earth because he's the one that God is actually talking to. But the temple's so corrupt, John has to go to the wilderness. See, sometimes God has to forsake what he's used because what he used cannot be bent to what he wants to do. And so we keep trying to prop up what God used because we can't see that God is not using that anymore because that will not bend to what God wants to do. All right. Just an amazing Mary and Elizabeth and their. How about another woman? How about Mary Magdalene? God can't use her. I mean, she had like seven demons in her. You just sit and be quiet. God raises up apostles. They are messengers to the body. But God raised up Mary Magdalene, who was a messenger to the apostles. He uses a woman to be a messenger to the apostles to tell them he is risen. As far as they know, someone took his body. She's the one who declares to him he is risen. He used a woman to declare. And somehow we've come up with a doctrine. Women can't preach. If a woman's divorced, she's pretty much relegated to doing nothing. If she's single, certainly can't have her preach then. You know, because that's dangerous. Like, the woman's dangerous, not the man who wants to sleep with her. Well, you know, that woman made that man fall from his marriage. No, that woman didn't make him fall. He fell. Right. Stop blaming the woman. I mean, she sinned too, but let's... Come on. That woman you gave me hasn't worked yet. God has been buying that line forever. Jesus, Paul, David, all had women around them. All trusted them. Ronald Reagan had Nancy. And at her funeral, Jim Baker got up and said, you know, Ronald had this great gift in him that he could see the good in people. He could just see it, and he could see their good side. And he said, Nancy had that too, but Nancy had one more gift. He goes, it was the gift of discernment. That's what he said at her funeral. He said, she could tell who was there to just row their own boat and who was on board for what they were doing. And she could tell the difference. He said, Ronald knew it, and Ronald trusted Nancy when it came to picking staff. See, Ronald Reagan was a great president, one of my favorite presidents in history, but without Nancy, he might not have been as good. See, women are important. They need to be honored. Now, what really requires that is women honor women. Because let me tell you, some of the hardest things I found is how women can't honor women. Forget about men not honoring women, but women get jealous of other women. I always told my wife, the worst place to be is one promotion for five women in an office space. Bad place to be. And they're cutthroats. Why? Because there's not as many promotions, and so they're fighting for it. And it's like the, you know, lone survivor gets it, you know. It's like, but can you honor the women around you? And let me ask you this. When did Jesus become the Son of God? And his brothers grew up in the house with the Son of God their whole life and never knew it. Because to them, it was just a brother. John chapter 7, they're saying, hey, go up to Jerusalem. Hey, that's where they all go. Come on, your disciples want to see you. They're jealous of him. I'm sure mom has talked about Jesus. I'm sure mom has told the story. I don't think mom kept it a secret from him. She's probably told the story. See, you could be you have access to greatness, but that person might just be your sister. And therefore, you don't see what's in them. See, a prophet not being honored in his own town is not a great praise of the town. It's actually a spirit called familiarity. And it's why people don't receive, because they can't see where God's called them. One of the things I talked to the sons down there, sons and daughters down there, was Papa and Charles had prayed for us. And one of the things that some of the sons, me included, are talking to Papa Jack about is that he has to sit in the seat of an apostle, because that's what God's called him to do. And if he doesn't do it, then that seat always remains vacant, and we're not going to get what we need from him. We can get some stuff as a father, but we can only get some things as an apostle. And you have to be willing to sit in the seat, because if you don't sit in there, then there's no acknowledgement of it. And if there's no acknowledgement of it, there's no faith for it. And I told a story about going to see Bill Johnson for the first time, walking up the stairs, and the Lord saying to me, "You must receive the apostle, the name of an apostle, if you want the apostolic reward." Bill didn't call himself an apostle. There was nothing on his web pages, nothing in his book. I could tell he was an apostle, by the way, by what I read in the book. But it wasn't anything they called out and said at the time. But the Lord spoke that to me, walking up the stairs. So I would be positioned, because look at the way I view the person determines what I receive from the person, not God. God does not determine what I receive. Honor determines what you receive. If you receive a prophet in the name of the prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. You receive a righteous man in the name of a righteous man, you get a righteous man's reward. Your viewpoint of those around you determines how much you receive from those around you. And that's why most people, I have people come up to me, "Well, he's just my brother." I've had people who just call me their brother. I go, "Well, then that's all they get. They only get what a brother can provide." You know what a brother doesn't provide for you? A place. Fathers provide places for sons and daughters, not brothers. I'm trying to teach this to the sons down there, because there's new sons, and we're trying to teach some of the aspects of kingdom. And it's the kingdom. By the way, the kingdom is fathers and sons. It's family. You know, Randy Leshner, we called him Pastor Randy, but he was always Prophet Randy in my heart. You know, he was always a prophet and a father. As a father, I received one thing. As a prophet, I received the mantle. But if he was my brother can't give me that mantle. The brother can't give me that gift. Why? Because that's an inheritance thing. Do you understand the difference? I mean, think about if you were called to be the messenger of the apostles and you once had seven demons in you. You know what Jesus does? You know, they didn't receive her message. You know what Jesus does? He rebuked the disciples when he shows up. He rebukes them. Because they probably thought, "Hey, she's just a woman. We're the apostles." I mean, he chose us. I mean, he handpicked us. And Jesus rebukes him. He says, "Why didn't you believe when you heard the story?" Paul was someone who had women around him all the time. Sometimes it's because the women are just more sensitive to the Spirit. And sometimes because the men are working. Right? But he had women. You could read through the book of Acts. Paul was always doing stuff in women's houses. And well, you got to be careful. You don't want, you know, you don't want to fall, or, you know, you don't want to give, you know, give them a reason to say anything. And you, the only reason they think every man's screwing around is because they are. And what do you think? You know, think you're going to stop someone from falling? How do you stop someone from falling? Do well. Get as far away from the doorway as you can. Get all the way in the house so the only thing you have is the presence of God, the things of God in mind. You're constantly, you know, don't have one foot in the world and one foot in the kingdom. Try to get all the way in. Get all the way in where you're surrounded with faith, surrounded with those who believe. Don't forsake Scripture when you hear it. Don't forsake the Word of God. God can use anybody. But he won't just use anybody. He can. He can use anybody. But he's actually going to use those. Like he used Pharaoh, but you don't want to be used. Like he used Pharaoh. And Pharaoh brought about his will, but you don't want to be used like Pharaoh. Okay? So being used isn't what you want. You don't want to be used by God. You want to be well-pleasing. And those who are well-pleasing do the little things well. They love well. They read the scriptures. Why? Their life. Every word is spirit in its life. That's why I don't know how. I talk to people. They go, well, I just feel like, you know, when I read the word, you're reading it wrong. I've never read the word and felt like God doesn't love me. Because when I got saved, look, as a Catholic, how many people grew up Catholic in here? Anyone else grew up Catholic in here? Well, you grew up Catholic. Me and Carrie, right, sister? Me and Carrie grew up Catholic. We're card-carrying members. According to our parents, we're not really out. We've just been absent. It's like the mob, you know. You're just never out. You're just in witness protection program. When I got saved, Russ Cochran, the assistant pastor who prayed the prayer with me, said to me, you have a Bible? I said, yes. He said, read it. This is the word of God. It is truth and it is life. Read it. I went, really? Because see, growing up Catholic, they never talked about the word that way. There were letters. It was the reading from Paul, a reading from the Gospels. But it wasn't, this is the word of God. This is what God has said. This will bring life to you. I wasn't taught that. When I was taught that, that was on December 4th, 1989. I can remember the day that I got a revelation of what this was. Every time you get a revelation, it reveals who God is. And the Word of God is living and it's powerful. It is able to divide asunder what is the soul and what is the spirit. God, what is my thinking? What's your thinking? And it cuts. I needed it to cut because I had some stinking thinking. Just because I got saved didn't mean I had good godly thinking. I didn't have it. I had to learn it. I had to apply it. I had to work it. I had to work the grace on my life. See, a lot of times people get saved and they say, oh, you don't have to do anything, you're saved. They don't even get people baptized anymore. Don't worry about it. Forget about baptism of the Holy Spirit. God will take care of it. He didn't tell them to take care of it. He told us to take care of it. Now, he can in our absence, but it doesn't mean we're well-pleasing when we don't do. Advocating our job to the Holy Spirit is not more spiritual, it's lazy. Why then preach? Holy Spirit can do it. But he didn't tell the Holy Spirit to preach. He told us to preach. I don't want to upset anybody. Upset somebody! You don't realize they're standing on their head anyways. Maybe you'll just put them back on their feet. I mean, it's like there's a lot of spiritual nonsense out there. Sounds real spiritual. Yes, he really trusts. God will disciple. Doesn't say God's going to disciple them. So let's disciple them. I don't know how else to do it. Don't you know you're a woman? Don't you know you're the bride of Christ? The wife of God? It's Mother's Day. It's the church's day too. Why? Because that's what the church is. It's the mother of God. Not torchbearers, but the body of Christ. It's the nurturing arm of the kingdom, of the body, is the church. And it's a very honorable thing to be a woman. It's time for women to rise up. Stop being a victim. I didn't say you're not one, just stop being one. That doesn't mean like kill somebody before they kill you. It just means know who you are in Christ. You have the same rights to the throne as any man ever has. And you need to be treated with such honor and respect. And the church has done a very poor job of honoring women. Let me see if I can expose some of those things. Some of it might expose women. Do you listen when a woman preaches? Or do you tune it out? Do you think women should have women's meetings so they can talk about women's stuff? Do you think it's wrong for a divorced woman to preach? Why don't you think it's wrong for a divorced man to preach? Do you think a woman being submissive to her husband means she's underneath him? Because that's not what it means. There isn't an order. By the way, I don't believe women should, emasculate their husbands. I don't think a woman rising up means now I'm going to be disrespectful to my husband. That won't get you nowhere. So don't do it. Randy once had a female on his staff years ago. And he calls me up and he goes, I tried firing her today. So what do you mean you tried firing her today? She thumped me on the chest and said, you're not firing me. She had been doing some things that were, obviously a problem. And she said, the Lord told me I never have to apologize to another man. Well, the Lord didn't tell you that. It wasn't that, well, it might have been your Lord, but it was not the Lord. Now, her Lord was bitterness and grief, and she came up with a doctrine in it that she thought would keep her strong. But do you think women shouldn't preach on Sunday morning? Or is that just something that disrupts your... There are some people, by the way, I'm just telling you, there's a lot of churches where a woman will not preach on Sunday morning. Not because the preacher doesn't believe it, but because he knows he'll lose half his church if he does it. I mean, you think God's pleased when we treat women like second-class citizens? I don't think so. And it's just very easy for me. You treat my wife like that, you won't be around long. There's the door. I'll make sure it hits you on the way out. And sometimes women, look, women just like men can be idiots. I get it. But it's not because they're a woman. Because they're immature. And let's not kill a whole, half the sex life off because one person was an idiot. Well, Eve sinned first. Well, where was Adam during all that? How far away was he? I mean, how big was this garden that Adam didn't know what was going on? It's time for women to really, be honored. And what it means by honored doesn't mean once a year. That would be a good way. Honor them always, all the time. I don't like some of the things where I had this. I was raised to be a gentleman, and when I was in the Navy, I was an E3. I hadn't been in more than a year. I hadn't even been in a year yet. I don't think. I had a second class supervisor, Roberta Newman. She's on my Facebook page. She was one of my favorite people. She taught me how to be an air traffic controller, and great woman. Loved working for her. I've had several women supervisors that have been amazing. And had this one girl, I opened the door for her. She was coming in behind me, and I held the door open. Next thing I know, I'm standing in front of my chiefs and my first class petty officers in a meeting with her. She has put in a verbal complaint because I opened the door for her. And she felt that was sexist. Felt I, you know, that was wrong and I shouldn't be treating her any different. And I said, all right, won't make that mistake with you again. So the next night, it was trash night. And every night you have to take out the trash. And the night before I took it out, and this night, Roberto Newman, who wasn't playing this crap, said, you, on your night, take it out because it's too heavy. Tell him to do it. I said, no, he can't do it. He's equal with you. You get up and take it out. She was mad because you can't have it both ways. Said you could have had it going really good for you. Like, you know, door opening, trash taking. He wouldn't have done any of that stuff. He would have done it all for you, but no. My chiefs are like trying to reprimand me and they're rolling their eyes like when she's not looking. They're like, we cannot believe we're in here, but we got to be politically. This is in the 80s. This started way back about being politically correct, you know. I mean, I've opened up the door for women and them get mad. And then most women are very gracious, like, thank you very much. By the way, I open it up for men too. It's just my habit. If I'm walking through a door, I don't let it slam on the guy behind me. I mean, it's just, I was just raised in civilization. You know, it's like, that's how I was raised. Like, don't let the door slam on somebody. It's like very odd behavior, I guess, for some people. But it's time to women to learn how to apprehend the kingdom and take their kingdom place and understand that the kingdom is not a man thing only. It's a God thing. It's really a God thing. And that, you know, do women have to preach? No. But if they're called to preach, they're going to have to go through the same process the rest of us go through. Ladies, you get to go through the same process men go through. Why? Because it forms character. Look, I sit with Papa Jack. He's got so many sons that I get to hear the stories of the ones who have fallen. Some have 500,000 member churches and they blow the whole thing up within 2 weeks. No one's there. They just blow it up. Fall. Won't repent. Just so you got to go through the process, you know. And doesn't matter how good you sound on Facebook. It's really how you're written in His book that matters. And there's the book of life, and there's the book of remembrance. The book of life is His work. The book of remembrance is yours. And Nehemiah said this, Lord, remember how I've done good. Remember, Lord, how I've done good for this people. Doesn't matter how they treat me. Lord, remember how I've done good. Do good and get away from the door and come and take your seat inside the house. I'm going to start talking about seats maybe next week, but the Lord spoke to me and says, I have a seat for everybody, but not everyone will sit in the seat. You know, David's seat wasn't filled up by another. It was David's seat. When God has a seat for you at a table, He does not give away the seat. That's why you're not supposed to sit in someone else's seat. You're supposed to let the king tell you where you're sitting. If you try to take a seat by your own choosing, not the one He's given you, then you get kicked to the back of the room. All right? Hallelujah. Let me pray over the ladies today. Can I do that? All right. Ladies, will you stand up? And if your husbands are here, if you have husbands, I want you to just put your hand on them. I want you to bless your wives. You can, you know, go join hands and oh, she's running over her husband. I was wondering where she went the long way. Okay. I was wondering where she was going. Where's she going up there? Huh. You can bless your mother if you like. Yeah. I'm sorry, I didn't include that. If you're here with your mother. You're here with your mother. You can go pray for your mother. How you doing? We got mothers, we got fathers. So, Father, we thank you right now for the women in our lives, the women that you've, you know, that our family, our mothers, our grandmothers, our daughters, and our grandchildren. And we thank you that they are equally in a right place in the kingdom. They're equally have access to you, equally have access to the anointing and to the callings of God. They equally have access to the stature and favor of Christ. They equally have access to the blessings of the Lord. They equally have access to the promises of God, equally have access to the increase of grace and power upon their lives. They equally have access to the holiness of Christ. That we bless them this morning in the name of your Son, Jesus. We speak the blessing of Mary. Let them be blessed like Mary is blessed. Let them find great favor with you. Great favor with you. Let them be messengers. Let them be epistles written of men. Let them be carriers of the flame. Let them be those anointed to bring power and healing and deliverance to the lost. Thank you for them. Let them take their seat within the house of God. And I thank you for it. In Jesus' mighty name, I bless them. With blessing, I bless them. And we call them this day forward, blessed of God. And you cause their lives, their homes, their businesses, their ministries, their jobs to prosper. Teach them how to do good. Teach them how to bring increase. Teach them how to steward the favor of God. And let it totally be upon them. Let them receive it fully. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen, amen, amen. Well, God bless you. Does anyone need prayer this morning? Sam and Trish. Would a couple people get around Sam and Trish and pray for them? Anyone else?